Hi everyone, very nice to see you all here. As Stefan said, my name is Anna and I'm going to present today in this webinar the work that I have been doing on the topic of the cost to consumers of CCS. And I have been using a methodology called product value chain analysis, and we will be talking more about what this means rather soon. But first, I would like to start off with some background. So in this figure, you see the territorial emissions within the European Union. And EU, they have a goal of reducing greenhouse gas emissions to net zero by year 2050. And as you can see in this figure, the industry sector accounts for approximately 20% of all of the territorial emissions within EU, which is, of course, a rather large share. And of course, we will need a lot of different mitigation options, or like a broad portfolio of mitigation options to be able to fulfill this goal of being net zero by 2050. And within the industrial sector, we of course have a lot of different industries, such as the cement, steel, where we have fossil emissions and process emissions, but we also, and of course then CCS is one possible way to mitigate CO2 emissions and to be able to reach this goal in the EU. And as Stefan mentioned in the introduction, I have been focusing both on the costs of CCS, but also of potential emission reduction of CCS. But we will start by talking about the costs. So we know that CCS is a high cost investment. And as you see here to the right on the slide, we have a very schematic figure of a product value chain, starting with the extraction of raw materials. Then we have the basic commodity plants. So this could be a cement producer, for example. Then we have the potentially intermediary industries, such as concrete manufacturers. And then finally, we have some sort of end product or end use, where we actually use the material. And since CCS is implemented at the basic commodity plant itself, techno-economics is often done using the plant as a system boundary, as you can see here in orange. However, as we can see in this simple product value chain schematics, the commodity or material that we produce at the basic commodity plant will of course be used somewhere, somehow, in some sort of end product. Otherwise, we wouldn't be producing it, right? So one of the questions that we will be talking about today in this webinar is what happens to the cost of these end products when we implement CCS at the basic commodity plant? And a little note here, and something that we will be talking more about later, is that in this work, I assume that we have what we call full cost pass-through. And this basically means that all of the cost increases that we experience at the basic commodity plant when we invest in CCS, we assume that those can be fully passed on down the value chain to the end use. So basically, we assume that different types of actors along the value chain, they won't take out any additional profit margins or similar. But the results that I will be showing you today is just the product of the cost increases that we experience with CCS. So, as I said, we will expand this system boundary from just being around the basic commodity plant to containing the whole product value chain. But of course, CCS is not only about costs, because it is, after all, a way to reduce emissions. So therefore, we will talk more about the CO2 emission reductions that we can achieve with CCS. And as you know, CCS is implemented, or the carbon capture unit rather, is implemented at the basic commodity plant, which means that if we have a high capture rate of our carbon capture units, we can greatly reduce direct emissions from that plant. However, most emitters aren't located on top of a CO2 storage site, meaning that we need to actually transport the CO2 to a CO2 storage site to be able to actually store it. And if we assume that we have the system that we have today with the types of transport modes that we have and their related emissions with those types of fuels, we will have additional emissions associated with these transports of the CO2 to a storage location. So the second question that we will be talking about today in this webinar is how are life cycle emissions related to the end product affected when we implement CCS at the basic commodity plant? So again, the system boundary is around the whole product value chain, but it's also including the transportation to CO2 storage sites. And as you might know, we have four different industries that are included within ACCSESS, and it's those four that I will be talking about today. So we have the cement industry, pulp industry, waste to energy sector, and refinery sector. And now in the next slide, I will be showing the case studies that I have been doing regarding then both the costs and emissions of CCS in product value chain. And first of all, for the cement value chain, we have been looking at a high-speed railway as an end-use case study. For the pulp industry, which is of course a multi-output system where we don't only produce pulp, but we might produce other things as well, we have been looking at the disposable diaper for the end products. Then for the waste to energy sector, or the waste to energy plant itself, is a more complex system in a way, since this is a multifunctional system where we produce, in this study, we have been looking at the combined heat and power plant, then we are producing both heat and electricity, but we also provide a service of waste management. And then we have been looking at housing as an end use in this work. And then in this work, we have assumed that the housing is heated through the district heating network. That is where the waste energy plant provides some of its heat to. But then, of course, we also produce municipal solid waste within the household, which is then fed back to the waste energy plant. And then finally, we have the refinery sector, where we have mainly been focusing on fuels or fuel production as an output from the refinery. There we have been doing two different case studies. We have been looking at air freight and trucks transportation, and we have been doing a few different scenarios where we have both a fully fossil refinery, but I have also been looking at cases where we replace a share of the fossil feedstock with biogenic feedstock, and then combining that with CCS. But first, we will be digging into the cement case study, and I will go through this quite thoroughly to then briefly show you what were the results that we have gotten in the other case studies as well. And first of all, we will start by focusing on the cement production costs. So now we will be zooming in again, and we will be looking at the basic commodity plant, or the cement plant in this case. And in this graph, you have on the y-axis the cement production costs in euros per ton of cement. And then I will be showing you three different cases or scenarios that I have been investigating. And of course, we need to have some sort of reference case where we don't implement CCS. We assume that this cement plant is already existing, so that we don't invest in new cement plant capacity, so to speak. So basically, we don't have any capital costs included in this production cost of the cement. And then we have, or rather in this reference scenario, we also assume that we don't need to pay for the emissions that we are producing at the plant, which we of course do to a part today, since the cement industry is included within the emission trading scheme within the EU. Therefore, I also have a reference a case but there where we include the CO2 costs, which would then be additional to the cement production costs when we also pay for our emissions. And there we have assumed that we pay 80 euros per ton of CO2 that we are emitting, and that we don't have any free allocation of emission allowances. Therefore, we more than double the cement production costs already by simply paying for our emissions within the ETS system. Then finally, we have our CCS case, where I have looked at post-combustion CCS. Or carbon capture. I have assumed that we have a 90% capture rate of this facility, and I am assuming that we have a mine as solvent. And then we see further increases in cement production costs. This is part of a few different factors. We, of course, need to invest in our carbon capture facility, which means that we have additional capital costs. We then again need to transport our CO2 to somewhere. We then, since we only have a 90% capture rate, we still emit some CO2. Therefore, we also pay a bit for allowances within the ETS here. And then we have some additional operational expenditures compared to our reference case. And now, in the next slide, I will show you basically the same things that we see here, but in another way. So I will be showing you the relative cost that we see compared to our reference case. So basically, what we will be looking at is everything that happens above this 100% line of the reference case. And this is simply because the final results graphs that I will be showing you later is expressed in this relative cost increase terms. So here we see these results in this figure, where, of course, the reference case don't have any relative cost increase compared to itself. But then when we add the CO2 costs, then we have a relative cost increase of 117% compared to reference case. And then for the CCS case, we have an almost 200% increase in relative cost. And again, when we are having the system boundary of the cement plant itself, then the CCS looks quite expensive, right? And that is why we would like to expand the system boundary and see what actually happens when we look at the end product where we actually use the material. But first, since we are also interested in emission reductions, we will also look at the emission reductions which we can achieve at the basic commodity plants or at the cement plants when implementing CCS. So naturally, we don't have any emission reductions when in the CO2 cost case, since we're only paying for our emissions, we don't reduce any emissions. But then in the CCS case, where I have assumed this 90% capture rate, we can see that we have 88% emission reductions. And this is due to the additional emissions which we have when we transport the CO2 to our storage locations. All right. Now we will expand the system boundary to be looking at the or more of the product value chain. And first, I would like to take you a bit stepwise through this. So we will be looking at first the cement and then the concrete. So this is exactly the same results that we have been looking at. So this is the cement production costs. Again, here we have the reference case, and here I have put in a line for the 100% when we look at the relative costs compared to the reference. And then, of course, we have some cement production costs, but then, of course, we want to sell the cement to someone as well. And then we are adding a profit margin to the cement. Meaning that we are adding additional things into this bar which are not related to the cement production cost itself. This means that the relative cost increase between the CCS case and the reference case is further decreased, because we are somehow diluting the impact that CCS has on the cement production costs in the value chain. And then finally, I also brought here an example of the concrete production costs, where we of course add in additional materials. We of course have the cement, but we also add some aggregates, we add some water and so on, which also comes with at a cost, right? So this means that an even smaller share of the total concrete production cost is dependent on the cement production cost, which means that the relative cost increase between the CCS case and the reference case is further decreased. Now I will show you basically exactly what we see in this figure, but in a line graph instead. So what we saw in the previous figure was the cement production cost. We had the cement selling price. We also had the concrete production cost. So basically all of these three points you saw in the last figure. Then I have a few more steps within this product value chain. We need to sell the concrete. So we add some sort of profit margin. And then we are looking at the actual end product, which is then the railway in this case. And there first we have some material production costs, or rather what we have purchased the materials for, because of course here we now don't have only cement and concrete, but we also have steel, we have plastics and so on, right? And then finally we have the railway production costs, where we also have added labor costs, which then makes the total relative cost increase for the CCS case, where we then use CCS produced cement and concrete, compared to our reference case, is only 1%. Then here in the next figure, I've also added the CO2 cost case, where we then, as we saw previously, we pay for the emissions at the price of 80 euros per ton of CO2. And then we see how that propagates in the value chain. And then, of course, we see quite similar cost increases on the final product. Now, on the next slide, we will be looking at the impact of emissions as well. So as we saw previously, we had a reduction of emissions of 88% when we looked at the cement production. But then as we move along the value chain and we add in more and more other materials which haven't been decarbonized and thereby come with their own carbon footprints, this emission reductions is further decreased. So when we look at the railway itself, we have a total emission reduction of 36%. And of course, this is a quite large emission reduction of 36% when we only have an additional cost increase of about 1%. And why we see this is, of course, largely due to the cement is a large part of the carbon footprint of the railway, but then a quite small cost. All right, now we have gone through the cement case study quite thoroughly, and I will now bring up this figure again where we see the overview of all of the case studies that we have been doing. And now I would just like to briefly show you some results of the other three case studies. So the pulp to a disposable diaper, the waste to energy to the end use of housing, and then refinery to air freight. And in this figure, I know that it's a lot of information right now, but here in figure A, we see what we just saw for the cement case study. Then when you look at figure B, we see the pulp case study. So from pulp to a disposable baby diaper. I'm just going to mention some results very briefly here. So we see that we have a cost increase of the diaper production of 3%, while we at the same time have an emission reduction of about a third. Then in figure C, we see the housing or the waste to energy plants case study. And again, we can see that we have a a cost increase of about 1%, but we can actually have an emission reduction of the utilities of around 80%. So for the cement industry, for the pulp industry, and for the waste to energy plant, for these sectors we see quite similar results, where we can have quite big emission reductions but with a small cost increase on end products. However, then we have the refinery case study here in figure D, which is a bit different. Since we have been looking at fuels in this case study, we know that the emissions related with, or the life cycle emissions related with a fuel comes mostly from the use phase of the fuel and not the production phase of the fuel. So here in the green bar and in the green line, we can see that we have a 3% emission reduction of the air freight when using CCS at our fossil refinery, but we also have a cost increase of 2.5%. So basically, we don't reduce our emissions very significantly here, and we have also a similar cost increase. Then we have also looked at a biogenic case, which you can see here in blue, and then a biogenic case with CCS, which you see in yellow. And in these cases, we have replaced 20% of the fossil feedstock with biogenic feedstock. And there, if we assume that we have responsibly produced biogenic feedstock, then we can have, of course, larger emission reductions, but we also have larger cost increases due to the biogenic feedstock being more expensive. And with that said, I am gonna conclude. So we have seen within the cement, pulp, and waste energy sector, the CCS implementation within these industries results in deep emission cuts, but it also comes with small price increases of these end products. But again, then the refinery sector behaves quite differently. And that was all for me. Thank you very much for listening.